Good morning, and welcome to the Universalist Church in which love is the spirit. We are glad you're here, whether you're here in the sanctuary today or anywhere in the world on our live stream. I'm Mike Zanta, one of your co-moderators on the Board of Trustees. If you're a visitor, we hope you'll sign one of our guest books at either entrance to the sanctuary or visit our webpage, westhartforduu.org, to learn more. There you can use the contact page to get onto our electronic mailing list, which is the best way for us to stay connected. We look forward to helping you become part of the Universalist Church.
Today we are participating with many, many other UU congregations in what they are calling the UUA Climate Revival Weekend. And so this is a day in which we're going to be attending to climate justice and all sorts of issues about sustainability and all of that. And how we are a participant in making the world better. Our kids are going to be doing that in a variety of ways through about 12:30. And after worship, we're going to have a discussion in the program center for adults mostly, or older teenagers too, about our green sanctuary work here that we've been doing for the last 5 years. What have we done? Why have we done it? Where are we going next? So I would encourage you after worship, if you want to go grab a cup of coffee, by all means do so. But please come join us back in the program center just behind the sanctuary through the hallway and join us for a conversation with Sabina Shelby and Katie Perry, who have led our Green Sanctuary work for the past 5 years. They'll be talking with us about where we've been and where we're going. Thank you.
Today we'll have fellowship and FIS call in through Zoom. If you need help finding your way to FIS call for a fellowship hour, any member of the church will be happy to guide you. Just look for someone wearing a Universalist Church name tag, and I've remembered mine the past few weeks. Will wonders never cease? You can find the link for Zoom fellowship in your weekly news or our Breeze calendar. If you aren't getting the weekly news, please do sign up for it on our website. And now, I invite you to take a moment to make your mobile phone silent, turn off your email, and put away your keyboards, and settle in for worship.
Blessed are you, our God, ruler of time and space, who has made us holy through mitzvot and instructed us to hear the sound of the shofar. Blessed are you, our God, ruler of time and space, for granting us life, for sustaining us, and for bringing us to this moment. Baruch atah Adonai, Eloheinu melech haolam, asher kidishanu v'mitzvotav v'tzivanu l'shmoa kol shofar. Baruch atah Adonai, Eloheinu melech haolam, shehecheyanu v'kimanu v'higyanu lazman hazeh.
If you have a home chalice, please light it as we light ours here in the sanctuary. Each year, we begin a worship service closest to or amidst the Jewish High Holy Days with the mitzvah of the shofar being blown. Thank you, Lance, for sharing this with us each year. Rosh Hashanah comes this week. And so today, as we think about climate justice and join other congregations in the UUA's climate justice revival, we are thinking about new beginnings in multiple ways. Rosh Hashanah, as the start of the new year, is just one of them. We light this chalice anew each Sunday in worship. And this moment offers more. A new year for the church, for our souls, for our communities. A new commitment, a new imagination, a new way to be for us, so that the world can find its balance once again, too. Our opening hymn is number 21 in the gray hymnal. Number 21. Please rise in body or in spirit, in the sanctuary or wherever you are, as we sing together. Please join me in speaking the words of our affirmation, our covenant. It's printed in your order of service and in the description online. Love is the spirit of this church, and service is its law. This is our great covenant, to dwell together in peace, to seek the truth in love, and to help one another. Please be seated.
So before we begin our time for all ages today, I just wanted to clarify, I know Reverend Adam already mentioned it, after the service, if you would like to participate in the discussion in the program center, there will be childcare available. The nursery will continue open until 12:30. And if you have children that would like something to do, so they're not sitting there with you, downstairs in Fisk Hall, we're going to continue our activities that we are going to be doing in the program center. So after the service, if you go down to Fisk Hall as a family, your children can stay down there. I will be there as well as a couple of volunteers so that you can participate in the discussion in the program center. Now, I would like to share a story. It's a very good story about a problem. Who's ever had a problem before? Now, this is what to do with a problem. And I would invite anybody who would like to see the pictures up close to come join me on the steps and the floor. Don't have to be a kid, adults can come up too. You guys can come up to the steps too if you want to get a little bit closer. So we have room for everybody. All right. So we're going to read a story called What Do You Do With a Problem? And the author's name is Kobe Yamada. Has anyone read this book before? You have? A couple of you have. Oh, you know what? I think it's the same author who wrote that one too, What to Do with an Idea. All right. We're going to try to do this with one hand. Bear with me. That's all right. We got it. I don't know how it happened, but one day I had a problem. I didn't want it. I didn't ask for it. I really didn't like having a problem, but it was there. Why is it here? What does it want? What do you do with a problem? I thought. I wanted to make it go away. I shooed it. I scowled at it. I tried ignoring it. But nothing worked. I started to worry about my problem. What if it swallows me up? What if my problem sneaks up and gets me? What if it takes away all of my things? I worried a lot. I worried about what would happen. I worried about what could happen. I worried about this and worried about that. And the more I worried, the bigger my problem became. Oh no. I wished it would just disappear. I tried everything I could to hide from it. I even found ways to disguise myself, but it still found me. And the more I avoided my problem, the more I saw it everywhere. I thought about it all the time. I didn't feel good at all. I couldn't take it anymore. This has to stop, I declared. Maybe I was making my problem bigger and scarier than it actually was. After all, my problem hadn't really swallowed me up or attacked me. I realized that I had to face it. So even though I didn't want to, even though I was really afraid, I got ready and I tackled my problem. When I got face to face with it, I discovered something. My problem wasn't what I thought it was. I discovered it had something beautiful inside. My problem held an opportunity. It was an opportunity for me to learn and to grow. to be brave, to do something. It showed me that it was important to look closely because some opportunities only come once. So now I see problems differently. I'm not afraid of them anymore because I know their secret. Every problem has an opportunity for something good. You just have to look for it. All right. All of our children can come join me. We are going to go to the program center. And when you get to the program center, we're going to find a spot on the floor. Please join me in singing our children out to their class. It is number 413 in the gray hymnal.
Voluntary offering, the sharing of our resources for our shared work as a religious community, is a spiritual practice for us. It's an opportunity to meet problems and find the opportunity within them. By offering your time, talent, and treasure to this community, you help us to serve our members, our friends, and the wider community of this congregation, too. So as part of that service, we share our general offering each week with organizations that do work in the world that brings us ever closer to creating the beloved community. And this month, we are sharing our offering with the Brain Injury Alliance of Connecticut. They provide support to individuals with brain injuries, their families, caregivers, and professionals, while increasing awareness of brain injury and its prevention. The mission is to raise voices and visibility of people with brain injury and improve lives through support, education, and advocacy. To give electronically, please use the QR codes in your order of service or the links in the description or those on our website to make your donation to our offering. And here in the sanctuary, our offering will now be gratefully received. May these gifts so generously given help sustain the life of this community, the work that we do together, and the ways in which we support the wider world of which we are a part. Thank you. Thank you. Please rise in body or in spirit as we speak together our congregational reading. It's number 648 in the back of the gray hymnal, 648. It's called Beginners. I'll read the words in Roman type, and together we'll respond with the words in italics. But we have only begun to love the earth. We have only begun to imagine the fullness of life.
How can we tire of hope?
So much is in bud. How can desire fail? We have only begun to imagine justice and mercy. Only begun to envision how it might be to live as siblings with beast and flower, not as oppressors. Surely our river cannot already be hastening into the sea of non-being. Surely it cannot drag in the silt all that is innocent. Not yet. Not yet. There is too much broken that must be mended. Too much hurt that we have done to each other that cannot yet be forgiven. We have only begun to know the power that is in us if we would join our solitudes in the communion of struggle. So much is unfolding that must complete its gesture. So much is in bud. Let's join in singing our doxology. It's in your order of service and the description online. I have a couple things to share with you on behalf of the congregation today. First, Lisa and John S.H. are glad to announce the birth of their grandson, Omar Alexander, on August 30th. After spending a little time in the NICU and with some needed treatments, he and his parents, Josue and Julia, are now home and settling in. The prognosis for everyone is good, though everyone also needs to recover from the stress of it all. Your congratulations and prayers for a solid recovery for the whole family are very much appreciated. I'm also happy to announce today is Shirley Lucas's 70th birthday. We wish you a very happy birthday today, Shirley. And please say hello and wish her a happy birthday in person during fellowship hour as well. I'm going to ask you to join with me in a moment of prayer with the words of the Reverend Leslie Takahashi. Source of life, we are grateful for your consistency, expressed in tree rings and rock formations, the half-life of stars and the depths of oceans, and in this persistent spinning of our planet. Life, remind us of the constancy you need from us as well, to temper our needs to fit within your limitations, to suppress our desires and our greed so that life may otherwise persist. This week in particular, we hold in our hearts and minds, and prayers, and actions. All those people in the path of Hurricane Helene. and all those communities who have been in the path of ever stronger and ever further spreading hurricanes and other climate-involved disasters as the climate crisis has grown. We hold in our hearts and minds, in our prayers and our actions, all those driven from their homes, seeking safety, shelter, a new place to live, one that might just maybe be safer than the one they left, one that might maybe, just maybe, have more water, cleaner air, more abundant food. In this moment, we also hold in our hearts and our minds, our thoughts, our prayers, our actions, all those things that we remain, that we keep unspoken within our hearts. And so let's take a moment in stillness together for those prayers as well. As Rosh Hashanah and Yom Kippur approach, we are reminded of new beginnings and the need for change. And so, holding those in mind, in this day, may we reconnect to our life-giving, breath-freeing connection with this world. And in doing so, may we be reminded of the changes we must pursue to make commitment to the health of our planet and one another, our everyday devotion. May it be so. Amen.
Our first reading is from What If We Get It Right by Ayanna Elizabeth Johnson. A question not asked often enough about the climate crisis: what if we get it right? What if? A mind-expanding question, an invitation to imagine, And goodness, do we need more imagination right now to create clearer visions of desirable climate futures? I'm talking about a future we can see ourselves in, where there's a place for us and the communities we hold dear. It will take a momentous shifts to ensure a reasonably safe future. How can we find the wherewithal and endurance to transform everything if we can't envision the outcome of our efforts? Before we fully commit our brains and brawn, before we go all in, it's reasonable to want some indication of what success looks like, some sense of what all this change will mean for our lives. Vague depictions of solar panels and electric vehicles and a future that may be less bad than it would be otherwise just aren't cutting it. So most of us saunter, we lollygag, we mosey away from the brink instead of running full tilt towards solutions. If we're honest, maybe we doubt that humanity actually can get it together, can really rally the depth of motivation and creativity required to face this unprecedentedly gargantuan challenge. But one thing is certain: half-hearted action in the face of potential doom is an indisputably absurd choice, especially given that we already have most of climate solutions we need.
Our second reading is from Climate Optimism by Sara Biabani. It is hard to be optimistic when it feels like the world is falling apart, being ripped open at the seams by the very people who have promised to protect it. Let me be clear, climate optimism is not the expectation of a salvaged planet. Instead, it is the proclamation of hope for a healthier and more just planet, and the pursuit of actions aligned with what needs to be done to get there. Whenever I feel dejected, crumbling under the weight of projections for rising temperatures and species loss, I remind myself that by several accounts, the world is better than it has ever been. And though our window to act is narrowing, our portal of opportunities is expanding. We are still facing several overlapping and intersectional global crises, all amplified by the climate crisis. But humanity is more advanced, connected, and well off than it has been at any previous time in history. When it feels like the world is ending, these reminders help to ground us and move us forward. This hope is what I aim to provide others with as well. Some might call this mindset toxic positivity, but for me, it is far from toxic. It is empowering, enabling me to make the change I want to see in the world.
Thank you.
When Hannah told me about the book that she was going to use for this morning's Time for All Ages, I had to laugh a little bit because I have been worrying a little bit. And it's not the way I like to exist. I'm frankly not good at worrying. Some people really cherish it, they enjoy it, they dig deep into their worry, and I just don't do it well. I don't like it. I'm actually a pretty positive person. I look for solutions when something isn't right rather than just sitting down and waiting for things to fall apart. But hurricanes growing stronger and excess heat too early and tornadoes showing up where they don't belong, that worries me. The lack of political consensus about the ways our world is changing, even though the scientists are in overwhelming agreement, and especially this, even though we all see and feel what's happening. We live in a place where people were fine without air conditioning for many, many decades. And now, everybody I know is trying to figure out how to put it in if they don't have it already. That worries me. And so I've spent a couple of days texting friends in Florida and Georgia and Tennessee, making sure they're okay as they possibly can be. Since the hurricane that came through here a few summers ago, I have been trying to figure out how to afford getting an emergency generator or solar panels hooked up to my house. I don't want to live through another 6 days without power. But see right there? That's where my worrying puts me right back into finding solutions. And I'm grateful for that. Feeling immobilized by worry and despair, it doesn't really help, even though it is a perfectly understandable reaction to an overwhelming problem. There are definitely moments where I think I could just crawl under my desk and hide for a little while, and maybe that problem will at least go away for a few minutes. But the truth is, that doesn't work. We know that corporations and governments need to make changes in order for things to improve. And we're getting messages like, plant milkweed and don't mow as much as you normally do. Now, to be clear, I have planted a ton of milkweed. And I'm actually kind of glad to mow a little bit less. I've changed out some of my grasses for other things, so it's not such a big deal. But we also need to ban Roundup and other toxic chemicals. There are big, big, monumental things that need to be done, in addition to the everyday things that we each can do. The fact that we can't do those monumental things individually, I can't go out and stop Roundup, right? I can't stop people from using fossil fuels. And so sometimes that can leave us lollygagging, as Ayanna Elizabeth Johnson says. If I can't do it, why bother doing what I can? And then as soon as I say that, something about that rings wrong. I should do what I can. And I should remember that what I can do is actually bigger than what I think, especially when I join together with others. It is far easier for me to move toward action and solutions with partnerships and community. And it's easier to see that when things are going right, even amidst what is wrong. So remember back a few decades ago, when we were in an absolute panic about the destruction of the ozone layer. There was a hole, and if the ozone went away entirely, we were doomed, pretty much, is the way we figured it out. And so we made changes. Policy, industry. We human beings figured it out, we made changes, and it got better. Much, much better. That doesn't mean it's perfect. There's still work to do. We did the same with acid rain. You no longer hear about people worrying that trees are melting or that their cars are being damaged by being left out in the rain. There are rivers in this country that once flowed with so much pollution that not only was there no life left in them, but they would burn with real flames. And now, they're largely cleaned up. Life has returned to them. They no longer burn. When things go right, we can see possibility that we struggle to find. Perhaps you remember seeing these articles. There were articles about how amphibians are so sensitive to pollution that seeing fewer and fewer frogs and toads is a very bad sign. I am very happy to report that where I live is packed full of frogs and toads and newts. To the point where when I drive in the evening, I have to go very, very slowly and carefully because they are hopping across the road in my headlights, and I try not to hit each one of those wonderful little creatures. I actually hear them singing from spring through summer. It may not be good everywhere, but it is still good around here. And I know that just like we filled in the ozone hole, just like we made the rain less acid, we can keep making things better for the frogs and the toads and the newts and the salamanders too. You might have heard about how the bees are in trouble. And it's true. Some of that has to do with pesticides. Some of that has to do with parasites. Some of that has to do with how we raise them and the pesticides that we throw around trying to protect them, and it doesn't always work. But I'm happy to report that I have no shortage of bees in my yard. And I don't keep my own hives. What I want you to hear is that the world is good. There are places that are still healthy and whole. And the world can be better. If microplastics are everywhere, maybe there's something we can do about that. If our greenhouse gases are too present, there's too much methane, we can do something about that. The world is good, and it can be made better, and that is what keeps me hopeful and imagining and determined. To my mind, there are two clear paths to take forward when we say the word climate. We can go from climate and climate change either to disparity, despair, and disaster, or we can go to justice and optimism and revival. And I know which way I want to go. I know which way our covenants and our commitments and values ask us to go. This weekend of climate justice revival with our other UU congregations is an affirmation of our justice work, our interdependence, and our determination to move forward from love rather than through fear. Let's be clear. We should be concerned about the world. We absolutely should be. We should find the best possible futures going forward because we love this world, because we love our earth, because we love what is good and true and alive and beautiful about it. Zara Biabani writes, "Climate optimism is not the expectation of a salvaged planet. Instead, it is a proclamation of hope for a healthier and more just planet, and the pursuit of actions aligned with what needs to be done to get there. Whenever I feel dejected, crumbling under the weight of projections for rising temperatures and species loss, I remind myself that by several accounts, the world is better than it ever has been. And though our window to act is narrowing, our portal of opportunities is expanding. It may be hard for us to fully realize that by several accounts, the world is better than it has ever been. However, while global poverty is still an issue, the percentages of those in stark poverty has decreased globally. Biabani tells us that while billionaires and massive corporations make too many decisions that shape our lives without sufficient guardrails and responsibility, more people experience democracy now than ever before. There are plenty of things to fix and some very disturbing trends, but globally, fewer babies are dying. People are living longer. More people are literate. More people have clean air and water than in a very long time. This world, even when it isn't perfect, and when has it ever been that? Even when it is in some peril, which is always true, this world is still good. And it's full of people who are trying to do good, trying to solve our problems. And so I go back to the story. This black rain cloud hanging over the main character's head, their problem that they try to run away from. And every time they run away from it, it gets bigger and scarier and more dangerous, until they tackle it and figure out what's going on with it and discover that in the middle of all of it, there is something beautiful. Opportunity. Ways to make things better. So let's talk about solutions. From the local to the global. For the past 5 years, we have been working toward our certification as a green sanctuary within our denomination. With the help of a dedicated but relatively small group led by Katie Perry and Sabina Shelby, we've done our own work here. We've changed our lighting, for example, to LED or other highly efficient options. Sabina even put in our own outdoor vermicomposter, a worm composting system, and I'm happy to say that it is currently working on a bunch of rutabagas gone bad from the food ministry. Moving outward, we have done work on food sustainability for ourselves and the wider community. We've collaborated with Levo International on hydroponic food production and distribution. We've worked on energy efficiency for ourselves and in collaboration with the Interreligious Eco-Justice Network, or IREJN, a collaborative of faith communities across our state. But what's beyond that? Well, there's an opportunity for statewide organizing with IREJN and the Greater Hartford Interfaith Action Alliance, also known as GIA, both of which are seeking to improve our relationship with the earth by repairing our relationships with communities and locations that have borne the brunt of pollution and harm from climate change. There's the possibility of sustainable heating, cooling, and solar power improvements here for us through our upcoming capital campaign. And then we can use that as an example of what's possible for other communities too. Not only can we step away from fossil fuels and sources of power, electricity that are not particularly sustainable, we could have air conditioning in this room right here. Our problems come with beautiful opportunities right in the center of them, if we but tackle them. And if we want to have global impact, we do that through partnerships and connections with other groups, with other organizations, especially the Unitarian Universalist Association. These monumental problems can only be served and solved with monumental effort. And that has to be done in partnership, in collaboration with other people, particularly the people who have been harmed the most, who are under the greatest threat, so that we help everyone to have agency, give everyone the power to make better differences, to be empowered to get what they need rather than what we think they should have. So where does revival come in? Well, the UUA is hoping that we think of this moment, but also this year, as a revival of our sense of possibility, of hope, a revival of our commitment to this world and to one another and to what we value most. Revival is more than just a grim determination to salvage a ruined world, which is not where we are, by the way. And it is more than just a single Sunday's worship. Revival is a call to remember, to imagine, hopefully for some of you to lead, to revive, to begin anew, to allow for the possibility of a whole new time in which we can ask, what if we get it right? Ayanna Elizabeth Johnson is not just an optimist, but she's also a scientist who studies marine biology, ocean conservation, and climate change. And she asks, what if we get it right? What if? This is a mind-expanding question. It's an invitation to imagine, and we need more imagination right now. Can we create a future that we see ourselves in, where there's a place for us and the communities that we hold dear? It will take momentous shifts to ensure a reasonably safe future. But one thing is certain: half-hearted action in the face of potential doom is an absurd choice, especially given that we already have most of the climate solutions that we need. It's within that question. What if? What if we get it right? That's where revival can be found. That a revitalized commitment to our life together as part of this glorious earth can be found. I don't know about you, I'm not particularly interested in some dusty post-apocalyptic cinematic vision of what the world is. No matter how many movies are made like that, I'm not interested. I don't care. I'm not willing to live in such a way that makes that more likely. I am interested in rainforests and coral reefs and thriving hemlock trees and permaculture. Excuse me. And permaculture and abundant food and clean air and clean water. I am interested in having to drive ever more slowly on summer evenings to avoid every single jumping frog. I'm interested in reimagining what's possible if we use the resources and solutions that we already have, and if we then create more solutions together. I am interested in the spiritual and religious renewal that comes with revival, that comes with recommitment, with climate optimism. I'm interested in soul-level transformation, moving from getting through the day or even just living lightly upon the earth, which is fine, but I'm really interested in growing into living deeply in our earth, living deeply interconnected with the whole of existence, finding in this life sacredness inspiration, even universal salvation of a sort, by embracing the reality of our interconnected and marvelous life on this planet. I hope you, too, are interested in possibility and hope. Let's take a moment together in stillness to be with this question. What if we get it right? If we get it right, there will be more frogs and toads for everyone. There will be more children's voices in moments of seeming stillness. There will be the opportunity for delight and joy and abundance for us all. May it be so. Amen. Please rise. In body or in spirit, as we sing our closing hymn, it's number 1064 in the Blue Hymnal, number 1064, called Blue Boat Home. Let us speak together our unison benediction. Engage with the world in peace. Have courage. Hold on to what is good. Return to no person evil for evil. Strengthen the faint-hearted. Support the weak. Help the suffering. Honor all beings. Please be seated. Before we begin our postlude, I'm going to remind you that we do have a discussion about our Green Sanctuary work at 11:30 in the Program Center. I hope you'll see it. We'll see you there, especially if you're interested in getting involved. And I'm also going to let you know that I have a copy of What If We Get It Right? And a copy of Climate Optimism and The Intersectional Environmentalist, which will all end up in our library, so you can check them out. And this book, All We Can Save, a book of little devotions and poetry, will be up in our meditation room in that library if you need it.